9 to noon, Friday football feast, BA in charge, Buffalo Wild Wings, Egan, aw, ain't you nice? Let's go! Taylor Heinicke, I heard that name come up between segments. What y'all talking about?
Well, you at least practiced with Taylor Heinicke. I know it wasn't, he didn't get a lot of play when he was here.
He did not.
Some preseason play and stuff, but, to his credit, I think this is his fourth or fifth team.
Yep.
When he had to start that Washington game in the playoffs, he gave Tampa Bay their toughest opponent of their entire playoff run.
Yeah.
And then last night, ends up coming in and leading Washington to a come-from-behind victory.
And looks really good.
I thought he looked pretty good.
Very good. I mean, you talk about ball placement, you want to talk about accuracy, all this other stuff. In the gotta have it drive.
Yeah.
The Giants somehow screwed up with the offsides at the end.
Oh, my God.
You know what? And that's what the NFL just always wins. That was a horrible game.
Yeah.
Right? Headliners like Taylor Heinicke is like playing quarterback, which at this point like is becoming a really fun story that people are going to be interested about. But team wise, it was ugly. The game was ugly.
Right.
Best rusher in the game was Daniel Jones. Yeah. Right? So, point being is, like, the NFL always finds a way to win because that game ends up being wildly dramatic at the end.
It does.
Just speaking about Tay-Tay specifically, that dude is a great human, first of all.
Is he?
I love to root for guys like that because he's a great dude. And a guy that, like, if he walked in right now, you'd be like, oh, well, that's an actuarial accountant for, Smith and Brothers across the street.
Yeah.
The dude's a stud.
The
dude can play, and that's what just shows you, like, there's so many guys out there, college players.
Yeah.
He went to Old Dominion, I think.
Old Dominion, yep.
So many guys out there that are really good college players that maybe their game doesn't translate to the NFL, right? Because that's the elite of the elite. They don't have the measurables. So they get weeded out before you even get to the point where you have a chance.
Right.
This dude gets an opportunity. That's where you talk about opportunities, right? A lot of guys, first-round picks, 6'5".
Bam.
Beautiful, right?
Yeah.
Can throw a mile. Terrible.
Yeah. Right.
We've seen them.
But they get the chance.
And now you get this guy who gets a chance, and every time he's got a shot, he's played well.
Yeah. It Taylor Heinicke and what he will do with Washington. Okay, this is not stopping.
Yep.
And it's like, I told somebody yesterday that if he's 85% of what he was in that Tampa Bay playoff game, he'll never give up the job to Chargers' beloved Stu Beard again.
Yeah,
that could be true.
Well, because in that Tampa game, he comes into it, and you know this man. It's and what the way you laid it out, I mean, it could be an hour of layering with coming from the bottom as opposed to perceived life at the top, what the mental wherewithal or perception that goes into it and inherently impacts the person's heart and skill set because of what they've been pat on the back,
that
good, all that, where when you get to Heinicke and his version of life at the bottom, and scratching and clawing for everything he has.
Love it.
But then you get in, you get on the stage, and now there are people there. And by the way, when you play in these games, Taylor, there's more than one deck. and he's looking around. Ah, a lot of people here. Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Well, that's where the rubber meets the road.
Yep.
Are you fearless?
It's a proving
ground. Or are you not?
It's a proving ground.
And that truly, in so many phases of life, National Football League, jobs, you don't have to be cutthroat and cut people down and walk over everybody disrespectfully. The fearless gene is something that is an absolute separator.
Yep.
And he has it.
Man, I mean,
he is just fearless.
Yeah, he
bounces back when he takes L's.
Yeah. I couldn't be more impressed with his approach. That last drive, there was no panic.
Yeah.
There's no overthrows, there's no underthrows. He was as accurate in that drive as he was all night. That little low ball he threw to McLaurin, like I think on that third down.
Yeah.
Like, McLaurin, sorry. That's the only place that ball could have been.
Wow. Yeah.
And like you're talking about a third and seven, like I gotta have it situation. Yeah. Like that's where it's the proving ground where it matters. I couldn't be more proud.
Now did you see it coming?
That chip on his
You
see why?
Here,
did you see it coming? Back in when he was in training camp, practice, and stuff.
But having said that, would you say he's going to be a starter and be that?
Chad didn't even know he was on the team.
That's not true. but the thing you did notice is the kid could play.
Yeah.
The kid could flat out play. Now, was he good enough to be a starting quarterback in the NFL? I don't know.
No, I think he is.
I think he is now.
Yeah. But it's the fearless bit. I'm not kidding you.
He's like that. He's got that it factor that you can't describe. It's like grit. You can't describe what it is.
There's
you
the just, difference between I don't give a F, I don't care,
yep.
and calculated, you know, calculated fearlessness
yep.
that has moxie to it, but you're smart. And you know the plays, and you know how to get into the checks.
Yep.
I'm telling you, man, that Tampa Bay defense, as we know, is unbelievable.
Yes.
It's the playoffs. There's a cliched no tomorrow. He's in a stadium with two decks, and Captain Cool's on the other side of the field.
Yeah, good luck.
And I think he threw for three. I know he ran for one.
Yep.
He had or threw for whatever. He had an unbelievably moxie-laden game. Like, I respect Tom. But I don't care who he is right now,
yeah.
and I don't care about these Levante David and these nice
right.
clients. I'm here to save my career,
yep.
and I'm here to take care of my pedigree and my lineage. And he came through.
Yeah, I think looking at that is you over the course of going from the bottom to the top, like
yeah.
he's done right, and he's battled that his whole life of being an undersized quarterback. Nobody knows his name, goes to Old Dominion, so he was lightly recruited.
Yeah.
Right? Now he comes and gets a shot, and he just battles. That chip on your shoulder, that level of I'm so determined, I'm going to find a way. Like, that dude, if he's out of the league next year, I'll hire that guy. Because guy's going to
yeah.
find a way. Right?
Yeah.
That's the guy that you
right.
want on your team.
Well said.
No matter what you're doing, you want him on your team. And he's just a good human on top of it, which is what you want to cheer for.
Remind me again. So it's preseason like 5 years ago, and
I don't remember anything.
But he put his foot through a window,
yeah.
right? And he lost. He lost the he got cut that preseason,
yeah.
I believe.
Yeah.
But he had looked really promising, and I think there was a lot of steam about him potentially being a backup.
Yeah.
But he put his foot through a window and cut his foot up.
We didn't need him anyways, right?
You know,
we don't need long-term backup.
No,
quarterbacks
no,
here.
We certainly
no,
not.
So gosh, no. Gross.
You wonder just how different it all would have been.
Yeah.
Is Kirk Cousins on this team had he not put his foot through a window?
Or had he stayed here, would he be out of the league already and
yeah, right,
be
maybe.
An actuary?
Wow. Yeah, maybe
you know?
He would be.
Damn. Maybe it happened for a reason,
yeah.
and now he gets thrown down this long, winding path, and now he gets his chance. And here's where it comes to for me, though, is let's say he has a couple bumps in the road these next few weeks.
Yeah.
Are they willing to stay with him on this short, you know, he's had a short amount of success, and this is where the NFL world comes in, be like, nope, we got to win now, we have
yeah.
to win all the time.
Yeah.
And that's why that leash is so short, especially that position, let's be honest.
Yeah.
And you have a guy behind you that's gone everywhere and found a way to win big games, right, with the beard and everything.
Right.
Who's going to get healthy?
Is he out for the year?
Six to eight.
Yeah, it's like 8 weeks. Yeah.
So he's got a great 6 to 8 week run right here where he could win his job right now.
He could. And, you know,
started last
poor night. Ryan Fitzpatrick. I mean, and, you know, God bless him, like 15 years in the league. He's made all of his money or whatever.
Yeah.
But every place he goes.
Yep.
And there's constantly somebody trying to actively take his job.
Yeah.
He just never gets to just like go be the starter.
But everybody always loves him. Everybody
they
you talk
do.
To
right.
loves that guy.
But
yeah.
see, he goes places and things go wrong for other quarterbacks on the team.
It's true.
Like he's in Miami and Tua sucks.
Yeah.
Okay, Stu Beard's gone. Tua goes to Belichick and wins.
Yeah.
I mean, granted, he might not have the greatest game in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Guess who was in the winner's circle at Gillette getting his picture taken? We're all cashing bets.
Yeah.
It's Tua.
It's yep. Tua.
Tua till you're satisfied.
Yeah.
So Stu Beard leaves. Fitzpatrick leaves. Tua gets in the winner's circle. And Fitzpatrick gets the money in Washington, but then he gets hurt now in a crazy twist of fate, and now it's Taylor Heinicke getting the money.
I know. Amazing story. It's
yeah.
just, you know, you can't always know how these things are going to turn
so
out.
So I'll ask you a question. So tell me about the Cardinals' weapons offensively, because there's a long list. Here's how I looked at this game was, and maybe it's still the Aaron Rodgers of old. We haven't seen that, obviously, but if you get this guy on the run, he's actually better on the run than in the pocket.
Yes,
and he obviously, again, big fan of Murray. I think he's very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
But he's also not that week one good every week either. He's got to prove it, too.
He hasn't been.
He has to prove it, is my point. As bad as you know, maybe we were in some spots, he has to prove that he can do that same thing week in and week out as well.
Well, if he does what he did last week in and week out, he's going to win the MVP.
Right.
He looked that good last week.
But that's
week,
the hardest thing to do in the world. Against these defenses,
it is hard.
And I like us coming back 1-1.
Do you? I hope you're right.
Well, yeah, how are we going to do it though?
They've got
Well, I mean, Kendricks didn't practice yesterday. If he doesn't practice today, you know how that goes. He ain't going to play.
Yeah, if he's not out there today, I'd be very concerned because he's going to be very important in this game.
Hey, he will.
In that position. Right. Love what Vigil did. We talked about Vigil a lot last week. Love what he did last week.
He was on the injury report this week, too.
Yeah, of course you did because Zimmer compared Vigil to you. Of course. Now Nick can't lose.
Well, it was a slap in the face at first. Now I'm like, hey, that's pretty good.
That's not so bad. I'll take that.
I love it.
That. Yeah.
Keep it up, man.
So Larry Fitzgerald's gone.
Yep.
And they move Chris.
For now.
Yeah, for now.
Until December 1.
Yeah, but that, which might happen.
Playoff run.
That's right. He might be a Buccaneer at that point.
Oh, gosh. I hope not. Come home.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Come home. Come on.
I wish he would. So they move Christian Kirk into the slot, and he erupts for 2 touchdowns.
Yep.
They got DeAndre Hopkins. He's very good. They don't really have a tight end. Their running backs are pedestrian running backs.
Yep.
And that, to me, has got to be shutting down the running game and getting them predictable in the pass is a huge part to what the Vikings can legitimately accomplish.
Yeah.
They don't need to get beat by James Conner and Chase Edmonds.
No.
And don't let those guys get you, period.
Same.
Shut that running game down,
and
then let's make them pass.
I'd love to see a situation where, and I don't know if this is even in their playbook, but you have to get inside heavy pressure up the middle on Murray, and you got to force him to try to flush.
Now, he's great when you flush him.
No, I say that because what Zimmer will do is, hypothetically, this is going to be the game plan, is to cage rush him, where your ends don't get above the quarterback so he can spin out, and don't dive in low to come underneath where he can spin out and get outside. So if you get heavy pressure at the middle to force out, and then you cage with your ends, now you can trap him in and make him throw from a bucket, right?
Which is what you
have to do.
That was sexy.
So if you don't accomplish that, right, you're going to probably have a hard time containing him.
Yeah.
But to cage rush him like that means coverage has to be there. Initial coverage has got to be there. So talking about Breland when I was walking in, right, when I got in the car, you're talking about the yards he gave up.
Yeah.
That's going to be vitally important. Patrick Peterson might be a little motivated going back to Arizona.
Yeah. I hope so.
Right? So the point being is we have to rush him that way. Now, my point is Ev going to play inside a lot, probably in 3 technique. Can we move our other elite pass rushers inside so they're not just caging a guy?
Mm-hmm.
We have guys that can just be out there and be a cog in the wheel out there.
Yeah.
Do you want to have Daniil Hunter cut him loose? Maybe you cut him loose on the inside. I'd like to see it, see what happens. If not, you got to post him up outside and not let Murray get outside. It has to happen.
In closing here, I'm glad you brought that up because when it comes to being a linebacker, say a 3-4 linebacker, you know, the guy, Von Miller.
Yeah.
That's one example.
He's a DN, basically.
Who stand up on the outside.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is it with Hunter and Wanham, Weatherly to a certain extent,
they're
now not a lot, but they're standing up and threatening. Am I going to run in there and blitz, or am I going to drop in coverage, or am I just going to stand there and, like, shadow or what?
Yeah.
I can't believe it's that easy to take somebody like Daniil Hunter, who has spent the majority of his life with his hand in the cliched grass, playing in the stance in a 4-3 defense, to just stand up and all of a sudden be good at that and know the nuance.
Right.
Is that a fair way to look at it?
I think it's a fair way to look at it because you have to think about, you literally draft for kids that have played that position because they're used to seeing things standing up. Because when you're standing up and you're as a D-end, now you're seeing the whole picture.
I bet.
Now you're a linebacker, right? So now you see a motion on the other side of the field, and you start to think, like, is that involve me? Do I have to contain? Like, you start thinking, like, if I have Ev and he's down to a three-point, like, I want him to see as little as possible. Like, I'll help him, right? He knows his job. If he's got this gap, he's got to contain it.
Yeah.
And very few times, if he's an end, do those motions really matter to him.
Yeah.
So when you stand up, you see that. I don't think it's a natural thing for these big guys to go from a 3-point to stand up, you know, but we'll see how it plays out.
What got into you in 2008? Because
Just putting up numbers.
Well, I mean, you played the Arizona Cardinals a million times, and in 2008, man, you had 5.5 sacks.
Could they not block me? Oh, not in that game.
No, in the season.
In the season, yeah.
But again,
that'd be a good game.
Yeah,
I got Kurt Warner.
Chandler
though.
Jones just did that, by the way.
Yeah, I know.
You are forever leading tackler guy.
Yeah,
shoot the gap guy because you're smart. You know the plays.
Yeah,
tackle for loss guy. But never thought of Chad Greenway as sack guy. He had 5.5 sacks in 2008.
No Pro Bowl, by the way.
And over 1, 2, 3, I mean, you almost didn't have that the rest of your career. You had 0-09, 1-2010, 2-2011, then 3-12, 3-13.
Yep. That's about right.
What the hell got into you that year with five and a hook?
A lot of those situations are add-on blitzes. So back then, we'd go to man coverage on third downs, and I'd have said back, right?
Yeah.
The back end.
Right.
So as soon as he inserts himself into the rush, I can add on. And I have to know where he's at, but I can go add on the blitz.
Right.
I know I got at least two of those off of called blitzes.
Right.
Whereas if the tight end blocks out, I go. If the tight end blocks down, goes. That sort of a situation.
Yeah.
Or I look like I'm a man coverage trying to trick him. That worked pretty well, actually. And that
coffee house?
Yeah. And a little bit of a coffee house.
Yeah.
The coffee house comes, where you're like, I'm in coverage, dropping back.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm coming.
Yeah.
So a lot of those were me just being a little more creative rather than a called blitz.
Yeah.
The sacks at the end of my career under Zimmer were more called pressure, double A gap. So
one of the first sacks of your career, you said it, was Kurt Warner.
Yeah. Jake Delhomme.
That's
pretty
sweet. Wow.
Jake Delhomme was one. Kurt Warner, I think, was like two or three.
Yeah, he was near the end of that 08 5.5.
I laid him down. He's an Iowan.
Right.
You know, UNI guy.
He's begging
groceries.
That's the best. Yeah.
He's like 42. I just laid him on the ground.
Oh, that's so nice.
Hey, Kurt.
That's sweet.
Hey, Kurt. Nice to meet you. Yeah.
Now, Grey Duck Vodka today, this weekend, seltzer, everything going on. What's going on?
Yeah, man, we're going crazy. The seltzer is just, we literally can't keep it in stores, which is so fun. We've gotten so many fans from that. We're at the Moondance Jam. Go look for us at the Moondance Jam this weekend.
Hey. That's and north, right?
Yes. And I just got...
Like up by Hinckley or something?
I think it is Hinckley.
Yeah.
I just got told by Jerry over there, partner Jerry, we have dropped Grey Duck pint glasses off at all feast locations for the year.
Hey.
Oh, that's great.
For our $5 Bloody, you can get any location, feast location, all year long.
Damn. Not just on Fridays?
I think there's even a poster up. $5.75 Friday feast. Damn. Bloody,
oh, I like
with
it.
Grey Duck. So,
you guys are always stacking different ideas to keep it fresh.
Yes,
you know what I'm saying.
It's you got
like,
to.
It's never fat and happy stale related terrorism. Just sitting back because hey, we got Chad Greenway. You know, everybody knows him, and we got a good product and cool looking bottles with the state on the inside and the country on the inside of the state or whatever.
Yeah,
you guys are always thinking about changing and becoming better, man. I really appreciate that about you.
You bet. Thank you, man.
Chad Greenway, ladies and gentlemen. Weekly 9 to noon. PA in charge. This is the Friday Football Feast. Buffalo Wild Wings, Egan. It's K.